last week. We have a couple of friends who have rejoined us, and we are glad for that. And thank you for coming, and we're saying welcome back. Also, on a sadder note, this past week got a note that Pastor Carl Curtin passed away. There is, if you have access to Facebook, the announcement from the conference is on there, and it has contact information for, I believe, his daughter, for expressions and condolences. I met Carl through the conference a couple of times, got to know him a little bit, and when I came here, I found out that he meant an awful lot to an awful lot of people. So I want to make sure that I mention that, and again, I can get you the contact information and stuff if you want it. You have access to Facebook. Like I said, it's listed right up on there. Also, got a note from Esther that she asked about something that the other church has been praying about. The Brooks Mead family, there is a little child. He's 1 year old. He's in the hospital with stage 4 cancer. Apparently, he's doing a little bit better than he had been, but he is definitely in need of prayer. And it says, if you want to send a card, tell Patty. I'm guessing Patty has a little contact information. I know the other church, they have a mission fund, an offering plate that's next to the regular offering plate for just various things that happen. And they voted this morning to send a couple $100 over because knowing our healthcare system, they will have a lot of bills even if they've got good insurance. So keep those families in your prayers. Little guy, yes, keep him in your prayers, but he's probably not real aware of what's going on, but his family is. You know, I had a kid who was sick, you know what that's like. So, keep that in your prayers. Anything else to be brought to our attention this morning? Keep Joanna's uncle in prayer. He's still in hospice. And Geraldine is having some surgery this week, and so keep her in prayer. She's a little nervous. So, pray for her too. Anybody have anything else to share this morning? Well, if not, then let us be in an attitude of worship. I invite you to stand and join me in our call to worship. The Good Shepherd invites us to green pastures. We are refreshed beside still waters. When we walk through shadowed valleys, God is with us. We are comforted and reassured. God welcomes us to the table where love is expressed. We are invited to partake of the truth God offers. Our opening hymn, the church is one foundation.
Thank you.
morning's opening. Good Shepherd, we meet in your name, confident that we are known and loved by you. Here we draw close to one another and to you, expecting to be empowered by fresh insights to live as your people. We want to care for one another in life-giving ways. We seek to reach out to those who deny you or suspect us. Help us grow in love that is genuine in its caring and self-sacrifice. We embrace the wholeness you offer and dare to risk acceptance of a human role for ourselves and this faith community. Equip us for service beyond this hour of need. Amen. Our affirmation of faith this morning, the Apostles' Creed. Let's affirm our faith together, reciting this historic creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. The first lesson this morning is taken from the fourth chapter of the book of Acts. Here, when Peter and John have visited the temple to pray, Peter has cured a crippled man who has praised God and entered the temple with them. Peter and John have preached the good news to the crowd, but the religious authorities have arrested them. Acts 4, 5-12. The next day, their rulers, elders and scribes, assembled in Jerusalem with Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John and Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly family. When they had made the prisoners stand in their midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who is sick, and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved." Our next lesson is from the first letter of John. The author has exhorted his fellow members of the Christian community to love each other. This love is to be grounded in the love of Jesus for his disciples. 1 John chapter 3, 16 through 24. "We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses help? Little children, let us love not in word or speech, but in truth and action. And by this we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before him. Whenever our hearts condemn us, for God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God, and we receive from him whatever we ask because we obey his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he has commanded us. All who obey his commandments abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit that he has given us." The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
as a good shepherd, an image which is familiar to his audience. True followers, he has said, recognize the good shepherd. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved and will find pasture. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. John chapter 10, verses 11 through 18. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand who is not the shepherd does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because the hired hand does not care for the sheep. And the good shepherd, I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason the Father loves me, as I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father. The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth, the meditation of each and every one of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, for you are our strength and our salvation. Amen. When I was raising my kids, when the conversation turned around to, which fathers always do, in my day things were different, I'd always tell them, if you want to know what it was like when I was growing up, watch the TV show The Wonder Years. Remember that show? Kevin Arnold was this kid in a family in suburbia, post-war suburbia, living in a neighborhood where there were other kids his age. He had an older sister, kind of hippie-ish, flowers in her hair and stuff like that, and his friends in the neighborhood. And it was very, very, very much 60s. Vietnam War was on TV, which always had to be turned off for dinner. That's what my dad made us do. And Mom was there when we got home from school. Dad was out at work. Vacations at the Jersey Shore, all that kind of stuff. Very, very, very typical of the time. And the Wonder Years just kind of reflected that whole thing, which is why I pointed to it towards my kids. And I grew up in a little town called Northvale. Northvale is in Bergen County. It's right up on the very northern end. Matter of fact, if you went up the street I lived on and turned to your right and walked two steps, you were in New York State. You were in Tappan. So it was right there. Matter of fact, when my parents bought the house in late 1957, the mailing address was Tappan, New York, because the street was a dead end. There was no other way to get there. My dad had a cigar box in the basement that had all kinds of stuff in it. And one of the things was a return address stamp that said Tappan, New York. There were dogs in the neighborhood. We had cats. People had different kinds of pets. So all I knew about sheep were what I learned when my mom or dad would take me to Van Sawn Park and their petting zoo. I knew that sheep were soft. They felt nice. They would eat the little pellets out of your hand, like as if they were starving to death. And they were pretty mellow. They were just kind of there. Jesus was using an illustration to people of something that they were very, very familiar with. Now, he's speaking in Jerusalem, and Jerusalem, Bethlehem, is a suburb of it. It's right there. And in those areas, there would be sheep out in the fields, because the shepherds would take the sheep out to graze, to feed them. Now, some of the sheep were owned by the temple proper, and they used those sheep to raise perfect sheep for sacrifices. They would be sold in the temple. Anything that didn't measure up would go out to the marketplace. There were other people that owned herds of sheep, and they would send the shepherds out to take care of them as well for them. And the sheep would go out and eat. Now, in those days, back in those days, there were a lot of animals in the area. You think about it, when you read the Psalms, it talks about the cedars of Lebanon and these vast cedar forests with all this beautiful wood. Solomon used it for most of his building, and it was used all over and shipped and everything else. Well, those forests are long gone. The people basically clear cut down all the wood, and the animals that lived there left. But at the time, there were bears, there were lions, there were wolves, all these predatory type animals that sheep looked really, really good to. So the shepherd would, in taking care of the sheep, at night, put the sheep into an enclosure. Now there were two general kinds. One was from the heavy rains that came. The limestone hills would have caves washed out of them by that water running over and over and over and over again. And so the shepherd would bring the sheep into those caves, carve a feeding trough out of the wall on the side, and then they would lay down across the entrance to that cave. Sheep couldn't get out without going over the shepherd. Nothing could get in to get to the sheep. So the shepherd literally laid down his life to protect the sheep. Now, the sheep are not the smartest animals in the world. They're actually kind of like dumb as a rock. You ever see a Western? Pretty much any Western I've ever seen, there is a cattle drive at some point in that movie, right? And what's a cattle drive? You got guys on horses, making lots of noise, shooting their guns in the air, scaring these cows and getting them to run. And they keep doing that to keep moving, and some would stand on the sides to keep them going in the right direction, all that kind of stuff. But you can't do that with sheep. Because if you scare sheep from behind you, they'll start running. And they will never stop. They will run until they die. Because they won't turn around and see if what scared them is still there. So sheep have to be led. The shepherd goes out in front of the sheep to lead the sheep. So the shepherd leads the sheep. The shepherd protects the sheep. The shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. And like I said, I didn't know a whole lot about sheep. When Tori and I got married and we had kids, we went back to church and we went to the Bloomingdale United Methodist Church. And we became very active there. And I remember my pastor, his name was Sam Chong, told me at the time a story about this church he served. It was in Stillwater, New Jersey, out in the middle of nowhere, farm country. And the church actually owned a flock of sheep. Give you one guess whose job it was to take care of the sheep. Here's a hint, the word pastor means shepherd. And so he took care of the sheep. And each day when he got home from the office or visitations or whatever he was doing, he'd go over to the sheep pen, he'd open the gate and call, sheep, 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 and the sheep would come in, file into the pen and close the gate for the night. And they were in there safe for the night. Well, one day, he got delayed. And he wasn't able to get home on time. So his wife figures, you know what, I'll help him out. So she goes outside, she opens the gate to the sheep pen, and calls, sheep, 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 sheep. Because that's how she saw her husband do it. The difference was the sheep didn't even budge. They didn't lift their heads. They didn't look in her direction. They didn't do anything. So she tried again, sheep, sheep, sheep. No, same exact reaction. She tried and tried. She went over there. She tried getting the sheep, pushing the sheep to go. They wouldn't go. Starting to drive her crazy. Well, here comes her husband driving up the driveway. And he sees what's going on. So he kind of chuckles to himself. He gets out of the car. Walks over to the sheep gate. Opens the sheep gate. Goes, sheep, 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 sheep. Guess what happened? They all filed right into the sheep pen. I think he slept on the couch that night. See, they know their voice. The sheep do know their shepherd's voice and they will follow. This is why Jesus used this sheep-shepherd relationship as an illustration so much. Because it was something very, very familiar. He did that all the time. When you look at his parables, he's talking about situations that people know. And that relationship of him to his sheep is very similar to the shepherd to a flock of animal sheep. And Jesus says that we are, I love the way First John puts it, that we are as how does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods, sees a brother or sister in need, and yet refuses to help? We have been blessed. Terry used to work at styling salon at JCPenney's in Wayne, New Jersey, near the Willowbrook Mall. And there was a woman who worked in that salon with her. She'd come from India. She was an immigrant. And now, if you know anything about India, you know they have a caste system. You're born into a caste, and that's where you stay your entire life. No such thing as upward mobility. You're born into a high caste, you're of a high caste. You're born into a low caste, you're of a low caste. Well, this woman's family had money. They were wealthy. They had servants in the house. They had people to cook for them and take care of them and clean the house and all that kind of stuff. But at the entrance to her house, she didn't have a door. Piece of cloth hanging down as a door to the house. Because even though they had money, that was beyond their reach. I remember being in school writing a paper about people's impressions of Americans. And there was a saying that was said at the time, for people in many countries, places like India, to them the difference between a rich American and a poor American is the poor American washes their own Cadillac. It says a lot about how we're looked at by the rest of the world. Now, we'll look at something that, you know, okay, I can't buy a new pair of shoes every year because they're expensive and I can't afford it. And we look on that as a huge hardship. Forget the fact we got four pairs of shoes in the closet. So we have an awful lot. And all of it is given to us by God. And we are expected to take care of God's sheep, just as God always took care of his sheep. You go back to that hired shepherd who runs away. Put yourself in that person's place, okay? You are hired by some rich guy to keep an eye on his sheep. Take him out in the fields and feed him and all this kind of stuff. It's a decent job, it's honorable. People do kind of look down on you though, because you're not able to keep ritual purity laws by being out in the fields all the time. And the result of that is you're unclean, and so people don't want to be around you, because if they touch you and you're unclean, they become unclean, they can't go worship in the temple. But you got a decent job, and you put the sheep in the thing, and you lay down across the mouth of it. The other one, by the way, was a wall about this high, basically in a big square with an opening at the front. That would be the sheep cave. And so you're there, keeping an eye on the sheep like you're supposed to, and it's dark, and you hear a growl. So you strain and look through the darkness, you look over that way, and you see red eyes. One pair, two pair, three pair. You realize they're wolves. You realize those wolves are hungry. Now you got your staff. You can probably take out one of them, maybe even two, but three? You're going to hang out and take care of this rich guy's sheep, or you're going to leave and live? Really human reaction. Really, really human reaction. I remember when I was working for Woolworths, they sent me downtown when the store manager in the downtown store in on Newark Ave, which was a horrible place before they rebuilt Jersey City. It's where people hung out when they got out of prison. His wife had a baby, so he went on parental leave. And they sent me down there to run the store. And my thing was, what are you going to do when you're down there? I said, well, you know, what if somebody tries to rip you off? No one in the area? I'm going to hold the door for them and ask them if they have enough. Because they don't pay me enough. Well, if I was one of those shepherds, they don't pay me enough. You ever seen a pack of dogs or wolves? attack something, bring it down, I'd leave. I'd leave. But Jesus said we are supposed to emulate the good shepherd, the one that lays down his life for the sheep, the one who loves them and cares for them, and puts their well-being at the center of their person. Do we do that? How do we relate to that? That's what we're called to do, right? As a church, but also as individuals. And how do we live that out? It is what we're expected to do. To take care of Christ's sheep. To be a living example of what it means to live like Jesus did. Jesus ever shy away from conflict or danger? In this writing, Jesus himself says, I laid down my life. Nobody made me lay it down. I can lay it down or I can take it up. I have authority from the Father to do that. When those people came to arrest me in the garden, I could have said, I'm out of here. And God would be okay with it. It would screw up God's plans. But Jesus could have done that if he wanted to. There was a miniseries done several years ago that pictured Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. And the devil came to him during that time. Now, if you go back to the temptation stories near the beginnings of the gospel, right near the beginnings of Jesus' ministry, one of them says, and the devil left him until a more opportune time. Scriptures don't tell us what that time was, but I think this is a pretty good guess. So the devil comes to Jesus when he had just been sweating drops of blood and begging with God if there's some way to still accomplish this and get me out of this at the same time. Please, but what you want, not what I want. And the devil takes him and says, yeah, let me show you something. I want you to see what's going to happen as a result of what you're planning on doing over the next day or two. And he takes him and starts to show him the results of the wars and the purges and the holy wars that were fought in Jesus' name and the death and the suffering and the pain and the anguish all happened by people calling on Jesus' name. The devil said to him, you can stop all of this. Just walk out of this garden right now. Like I said, I think that was the more opportune time. Jesus doesn't. He says no. And he goes through with what God wanted. He never walked away or shied away from danger. Because he was confident that God had his back. And you know what? God's got our back too. God is there for us. Why? Because Jesus is our shepherd. The good shepherd that lays down his life for us. We live in a society today that is very, very splintered and divided. Pretty much anything I hear on TV or see on the internet, I expect it to have some kind of, especially if it's government related, some kind of comment about how the Democrats are wrong or how the Republicans are wrong. It seems like everything is a personal attack. Remember when they used to actually debate ideas? Sometimes. This world is in desperate need of shepherds to love the sheep. We have been given that task by Jesus. First passed down to the apostles, who passed it down, and passed it down, and then it came to us. What can we do in the middle of all this kind of stuff? How do we go about loving the sheep in the same way that Jesus loved the sheep? Like I said earlier, the other church had a mission offering they do. Just, you know, throw a buck or two or some change or whatever in here. And over time, it adds up. And they opted to give $200 to the family of that little boy. Loving the sheep, right? The method in which we use to love the sheep is going to be different for each and every one of us. Because we're different people and we have different gifts and graces. In other words, we're good at different things. The key is to keep your eye on Christ and on His commands and look for the opportunities that present themselves, and they will present themselves, because they always do. Because God is not passive. And God expects us not to be passive either. So as you leave this place today, look for the opportunities that God puts in front of you. Ways to love and serve the sheep as Christ loved and served the sheep. And you can be part of making a difference in this world for the sake of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Lord God, we give you thanks this morning for the tasks that you have given us to do. God, sometimes we shrink from them. We act like the hired hand. Our main concern is with saving our own butt, as opposed to loving the sheep with all that we are. Forgive us for that, God. And give us strength. Strength that we might stand up in the face of fear and anxiety and ridicule. God, this world needs your spirit, your people, your love. We give you thanks that we have been given a chance to model that, to be that, for those who we encounter. So God, we come to you this morning truth were to be told, a little hesitant, because we know we have not lived up to what we're supposed to be doing. And God, we're counting on your love, your care, your forgiveness. So we thank you for all of these things as we strive to live out our lives as our shepherd lived out his. And as we come near, draw near to you, we bring prayers for people we know of who are struggling with all different kinds of hardships and maladies. And we come to you lifting their names in prayer, because we know that you are able to do far more than we can ever hope for or expect. So we bring their names to you, not because we're so arrogant to think we know more than you do, but rather as a demonstration of our trust in and reliance on you. Little Jack with cancer, Lord, in your mercy. 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 Thank you, God, for hearing the prayers they spoke aloud, any that you might have held in our hearts. Turn them all over to you, confident in your love and in your power. We ask these things in the name of our Shepherd, Jesus the Christ, who taught us in prayer to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Those sheep that were kept in Bethlehem and vicinity, many of them were used, raised and used for sacrifices in the temple, in accordance with the law. Because the law said, okay, if you do this, if you commit this sin, the appropriate offering is this. If you commit this sin, the appropriate offering is this. And an offering might be oil, an offering of oil, an offering of grain, an offering of turtle doves, an offering of a bull or a ram, the offering of a sheep. And of course, on Passover, the formative event of the Jewish people, a lamb without blemish was slain for each family or group of families to eat at the Passover meal as an acknowledgement and a thanksgiving to God for what God had done for the people throughout history and what God was doing for the people then. On that first Good Friday, Jesus decided himself, made a decision, become that sacrifice for all time. Today we remember that sacrifice and those events in our church offerings. All of these things are all about giving thanks to God. For forgiveness, for love, for care, for being our shepherd. That is what our offerings are all about. A closing hymn, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us.
Thank you.
being shepherds, taking care of and loving the sheep, even at the risk of your own safety. That is what we are called to do. The best bosses, the best teachers, are the ones who ask you to do things that they have shown you they do, things that they model. Not that, I want you to do this dangerous job. I'm not doing it, I'm the boss, I don't have to, I have you. Yeah, that doesn't work too well, does it? Jesus gave up his life. Jesus not only risked, but accepted ridicule, torture, all for his sheep. What are you willing to risk or do for Jesus' sheep? May the blessings of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you today, tomorrow, and forever.